Course in Miracles, Original Edition, Chapter 11, Section 8, The Guide for Miracles. Miracles demonstrate that learning has occurred under the right guidance, for learning is invisible. And so what has been learned can be recognized only by its results. Learning is invisible. And so what has learned can be recognized only by its results. Learning's generalization is demonstrated as you use your learning in more and more relationships and situations. You will recognize that you have learned that there is no order of difficulty in miracles when you have applied these, your learning, to all relationships, all situations. There is no situation to which miracles do not apply. And by applying miracles, which is right thoughts, to all relationships, not just some, then you will gain the real world. Because in this holy perception where you're applying miracles and right thoughts to every situation, not just some, you will be made whole. And the correction of the ego, the correction of the split will radiate from your acceptance of it for yourself to everyone that Spirit sends you for your blessing. In every child of God, love's blessing waits. In every child of God that you meet, in every child of God you encounter, God's blessing lies. And in your blessing of the children of God is God's blessing to you. Everyone in the world must play their part in the healing of the world in order to recognize that the world has been healed. You cannot see the invisible, yet if you see the invisible's effects, you know the invisible must be there. By perceiving what the invisible does, you recognize the invisible's being. And by what the invisible does, you learn what that invisible thing is. In other words, you cannot see your abilities. They are invisible. Abilities are invisible. But you gain confidence in the ability's existence as the abilities enable you to act. And the results of your actions you can see. In other words, the Holy Spirit is invisible, but you can see the results of the Holy Spirit's presence. And through the results of your higher mind's presence, then you learn that your divine indweller is there, must be there. And your divine indweller must be there because what your divine indweller enables you to do is clearly not of this world or your life, because these miracles have violated every law of reality as this world judges it. That's how you know that your divine indweller is there, because what your divine indweller enables you to do is clearly not of this world. And that what my divine indweller just enabled me to do violates every law of reality as this world judges it. So, it must be there. Every law of time and space, of magnitude and mass, of prediction and control is transcended by miracles, by what your divine indweller enables you to do. Every law of time and space, of magnitude and mass, of prediction and control is transcended because what your divine indweller enables you to do is clearly beyond all of those so-called laws. Perceiving your divine indweller's results, then you will understand where your divine indweller, your Holy Spirit, must be, and finally know what the Holy Spirit in you must be. You cannot see your divine indweller. You cannot see the universal inspiration within yourself. But you can see its manifestations. And unless you see its manifestations, then you won't realize that your divine indweller is there. Miracles are Holy Spirit's witnesses. The miracles you experience in your life, those are Holy Spirit's witnesses, and all those miracles that happened in your life that defied all the laws of time and space as the world judges it, that is how you realize that it is there within you. The miracles that are done through the Holy Spirit in you, those miracles are Holy Spirit's witnesses and speak for Holy Spirit's presence. What you cannot see, like your abilities, becomes real to you only through the witnesses who speak for it. For you can be aware of what you cannot see, and it can become compellingly real to you as its presence becomes manifest through you. You can be aware of what you cannot see, and what you cannot see can become compellingly real to you as its presence becomes manifest through you. Do the Holy Spirit's work, for you share in Holy Spirit's function. And as your function in heaven is creation, so your function here on earth is healing. So do the Holy Spirit's work, because you share in Holy Spirit's function. And your function on earth, it is healing. So do the Holy Spirit's work. God shares his function with you in heaven, and the Holy Spirit shares its function with you on earth. The Holy Spirit shares its function of healing with you on earth, and in reality, in heaven, God shares his function with you of creating. Healing, creating in heaven. Healing, healing on earth. In heaven, I create, while on earth, I heal. And that's me sharing the function, sharing the work of the Holy Spirit, which we share. That universal inspiration that we share, do its work, which is healing on earth. As long as you believe you have two functions, healing and something else, so long will you need healing. So long will you need correction. For this belief that you have two functions, healing and something else, is the destruction of your peace. You thinking that you have some other function besides healing, that is the destruction of your peace. That is a goal in direct opposition to the Holy Spirit's purpose of healing. You see what you expect, and you expect what you invite. Your perception, in other words, is the result of your invitation coming to you as you sent for it. Whose manifestations would you see? Of whose presence would you be convinced? For you will believe in what you manifest. You will believe in what you manifest, which means as you look out, so you will see in. Two ways of looking at the world are in your mind, and your perception will reflect the guidance you chose. Two ways of looking at the world are in your mind, and your perception will reflect the guidance that you chose. whose manifestations would you see? Which way of looking at the world would you choose? I am the manifestation of the Holy Spirit, and when you see me, it will be because you have invited the Holy Spirit. For the Holy Spirit will send you its witnesses if you will but look upon them. Love will send you its witnesses if you will but look on them. Love will send you its witnesses if you will but look upon them. Remember always that you see what you seek, for what you seek, you will find. The ego finds what it seeks, and only that. The ego does not find love, because love is not what the ego is seeking. Yet seeking and finding are the same. Which means if you seek for two goals, you will find them, but you will recognize neither. By seeking and finding two goals, you will think that those two goals are the same because you want both of those goals. But the mind always strives for integration. And if the mind is split and wants to keep the split, the mind will believe it has only one goal by making them one. The mind always strives for integration. It doesn't want to be split. So if the mind has two goals, it's going to and wants to keep that split goals, those two separate goals, then the ego will believe, the mind will believe that it has only one goal by making it one, because the mind always strives for integration. We said before that what you project is up to you, but it is not up to you whether to project. because projection is a law of the mind. Perception is projection, which means you look in before you look out. And as you look in, you choose the guide for what you see and how you see. And then you look out and see its witnesses. The witnesses to the guide for seeing I chose when I looked within. This is why you find what you seek. What you want in yourself, you will make manifest by projection. And then you will accept it from the world, because you put it there in the world by wanting it. When you think that you are projecting what you don't want, it's still because you do want it. And projecting what you don't want because you still do want it leads directly to disassociation, because that represents the acceptance of two goals, each perceived in a different place, separated from each other because you made them different. Two opposite goals. Wanting to follow two guides. Wanting to follow two guides instead of one. Even when those two guides are complete opposites. And after that, the mind being split by wanting to follow two opposite guides, then your mind sees a split world, a divided world, outside itself, but not within itself. Now your mind looks out and sees a divided world, a split world, outside of you itself, meaning not within, a world outside myself, but not within. It's all my mind looks out to see when I accept opposite goals and opposite guides in my mind and believe I only have one goal, one teacher. Now my mind, this gives my mind an illusion of integrity. I see a divided world outside myself, but not within myself, gives my mind an illusion of integrity and enables my mind to believe that my mind is pursuing one goal. Which means as long as you see the world as divided and split with two opposite opposing goals, then your mind is not healed. As long as you perceive the world as split, meaning outside of you and not within, then you are not healed. For to be healed is to pursue one goal, one guide, the curriculum of one guide. To be healed is to pursue one goal, because you have accepted only one goal and want only one goal, which is to follow only one guide in your mind. One goal, one guide in my mind, love. To be healed is to pursue only one goal in your mind, one goal in your learning. And to be healed is to pursue only one teacher, only the one teacher of love in your mind. When you want only love, When you want only love, you will see nothing else but love. The contradictory nature of the witnesses that you see in your world is merely the reflection of your conflicting invitations. You have looked upon your minds and accepted opposition in your minds, having sought opposites in your mind. But don't then believe that the witnesses to your split mind are true. Because the witnesses to your split mind, they attest only to your decision about reality, returning to you the message you gave them. Love is recognized by its messengers. And so if you make love manifest, then love's messengers will come to you because you invited them. The power of decision is your one remaining freedom as a prisoner of this world. Your power of decision is your one remaining freedom as a prisoner of this world. You can decide to see this world right. That's because what you made of this world is not its reality. Because the world's reality is only what you gave it. You cannot really give anything but love to anyone or anything. Nor can you really receive anything else but love from anyone or anything. If you think that you have received something besides love, it's only because you looked within and thought you saw the power to give something else besides love within yourself. And it was only this decision to give something else within yourself, thinking you have the power to give something else besides love within yourself, it was only that decision that determined what you found in the world, for it was the decision of what you sought. I think that I've received something besides love because I looked within and I thought I saw the power to give something else besides love within myself. And because of that, I now perceive that I have received something besides love. You are afraid of me because you looked within and are afraid of what you saw. You are afraid of me. You are afraid of love because you looked within and are afraid of what you saw. Yet you, when you looked within and you were afraid of what you saw, you could not have seen reality. Because the reality of your mind is the loveliest of God's creations. Coming only from God, the power and grandeur of your mind could only bring you peace if you really looked at it, if you really looked upon it. If you are afraid, it's because you saw something that is not there within yourself. Yet, in that same place within yourself, you could have looked upon me and all your brothers and sisters in the perfect safety of the mind which created us. For we are there in the peace of the Creator, who wills to project His peace through you. When you have accepted your mission to project peace, then you will find peace. When you have accepted your mission to project peace, you will find peace. For by making peace manifest, you will see peace. You made it manifest. There it is. The holy witnesses of peace will surround you. The holy witnesses of peace will surround you because you called to the witnesses of peace, and they will come to you. I call to the witnesses of peace. I call to the witnesses of peace by projecting peace. By projecting peace, I call to the witnesses to peace. I accept my mission to project peace. I accept my mission to project peace. And in that way, I will find it. As I manifest peace, I will see it. The witnesses, the holy witnesses to peace will surround you because you called upon the witnesses to peace, and they will come to you. I have heard your call, and I have answered your call, but you will not look upon me, nor hear the answer which you sought. You will not hear the answer that you sought because you don't yet want only that answer of love that you sought. Yet as I become more real to you, you will learn that you do only want that love, that teaching, that guide. And you will see me as you look within. You will see me as you look within. And then we will look upon the world as God created it together. You will see me as you look within, and we will look upon the world as God created it together. Through the eyes of Christ, only the real world exists and can be seen. So as you decide, so will you see, and all that you see but witnesses to your decision. Your decision of what you wanted. When you look within and see me, it will be because you have decided to manifest truth. And as you manifest truth, you will see truth both outside of you and within you. Outside of you in the world and within you, because you will see it, that truth without, you will see the truth in the world because you saw the truth first within you. And so everything you see outside of you is a judgment on what you saw within you. If it is your judgment, then it will be wrong. What you beheld within that you now see without, if it is your judgment that you saw within and then without, then it will be wrong. Because judgment is not your function. If it is the judgment of the Holy Spirit within you that you see outside of you in the world, it will be right. Because judgment is Holy Spirit's function. You share Holy Spirit's function only by judging as Holy Spirit does. You share the divine indweller's function only by interpreting as your divine indweller interprets, reserving no judgment at all unto yourselves. You share the loving right mind's function only by judging as love does. You share Holy Spirit's function only by judging as Holy Spirit does. That means reserving no judgment at all unto yourself. Because you will judge against yourselves. But Holy Spirit in your mind will always judge for you. And so don't reserve any judgment unto yourself. Because if you reserve judgment for yourself to make, you will judge against yourself. But your loving, right, higher mind will always judge for you. Remember then that whenever you look without and react unfavorably to what you see, you have judged yourself unworthy and you have condemned yourself to death. The death penalty is the ego's ultimate goal because the ego fully believes that you are a criminal and deserving of death, as God knows that you are deserving of life. The death penalty never leaves your ego's mind because death is what your ego always reserves for you in the end, wanting to kill you as the final expression of its feeling for you. Your ego lets you live, but just to await death. And so the ego will torment you while you live, but its hatred is not satisfied until you die. For your destruction is the one end toward which your ego works, and the only end with which the ego will be satisfied. The ego is not a traitor to God, to whom treachery is impossible. But the ego is a traitor to you who believe you have been treacherous to your father. Your ego is not a traitor to God, to whom treachery is impossible, but your ego is a traitor to you who believe that you have been treacherous to your Creator. And that's why the undoing of guilt is an essential part of the Holy Spirit's teaching. You who believe you've been treacherous to your Creator. The ego is a traitor to you. The ego is a traitor to you, you who believe that you have been a traitor to love. And so that is why the undoing of guilt is an essential part of the Holy Spirit's teaching for us. Because as long as you feel guilty, you are listening to the voice of the ego, which tells you that you have been treacherous to God and therefore deserve death. And you will think that death comes from God and not from your ego. Because by confusing yourself with your ego, you believe that you want death. And from what you want, God does not save you. And so when you are tempted to yield to the desire to feel guilty, when you are tempted to yield to the desire for death, when you are tempted to yield to the desire for death, for guilt, remember that I didn't die. You will realize that I didn't die when you look within and see me. Would I have overcome death for myself alone? And would eternal life have been given me of the Creator unless the Creator had also given it to you? When you learn to make me manifest, then you will never see death, for you will have looked upon the deathless in yourself, and you will see only the eternal then as you look out upon a world that cannot die. I would like to look out upon a world that cannot die. I will see that when I look within. And seen the deathless in myself. Reality and redemption. Do you really believe that you can kill the creation of God, a child of God? The Father has hidden his children safely within himself and kept his children far away from your destructive thoughts. But you don't know either your father nor your brother because of your destructive thoughts. The Creator has hidden its creation safely within itself and kept its creation, its children, far away from our destructive thoughts. Destructive thoughts like you attack the real world every day and every hour and every minute, and yet you are surprised that you cannot see the real world. If you seek love in order to attack love, you will never find love. For if love is sharing, how can you find love except through itself? If love is sharing, how can you find love except through itself? Love is sharing. Offer love, offer sharing, and love will come to you because love is drawn to itself. Offer love, and it will come to you, for love is drawn unto itself. But offer attack, and attack will remain hidden, because attack can live only. But offer attack, and the real world will remain hidden, for the real world can live only in peace. And offer attack, and your real self, love, will remain hidden, for love and your real self can live only in peace. Your real self, God's children, are as safe as their father, because the children know their father's protection, and so the children cannot fear. The children's love, the children's father's love, the children's father's love holds the children in perfect peace, needing nothing, and needing nothing. God's children ask for nothing. Yet, the children of God are far from you, whose self he is, for you chose to attack your real self. You chose to attack God's children. And so, God's children are as far from you whose self you are. You chose to attack God's children, and so they disappeared from your sight into their father. Your brother and sister did not change, but you did. For a split mind and all its works were not created by the Father who could not live. A split mind and all its works were not created by the Father, and a split mind and all its works could not live in the knowledge of God's love. When you made what is not true visible, then what is true became invisible. Yet what is true cannot be invisible in itself. For the Holy Spirit sees the invisible with perfect clarity. But what's true is invisible to you because you are looking at something else besides what's true. The Holy Spirit sees truth with perfect clarity. Truth is invisible to you because you are looking at something else besides truth. Yet it is no more up to you to decide what is visible and what is invisible than it is up to you to decide what reality is. What can be seen is what the Holy Spirit sees. The definition of reality is God's, not yours. God created reality. God knows what reality is. You who knew what reality is have forgotten. And unless Holy Spirit and God had given you a way to remember, then you would have condemned yourselves to oblivion. Because of your Father's love for you, you can never forget God. For no one can forget what God Himself placed in his memory. You can deny what God placed in your memory, but you can't lose it. And because of that, a voice will answer every question that you ask. And a vision will correct the perception of everything you see. If you ask. For what you have made invisible is the only truth, and what you have not heard is the only answer. God would reunite you with yourself. God wants to reunite you with yourself, and God did not abandon you in your seeming distress. You are waiting only for God and don't know it. Yet still, God's memory shines in your minds and cannot be obliterated. The memory of God that's shining in your mind is no more past than future, being forever always. And so, you have only to ask for this memory, and you will remember. Yet the memory of God cannot shine in a mind which has made it invisible. Yet the memory of God cannot shine in a mind which has made the memory of God invisible and wants to keep it so. Because the memory of God can dawn only in a mind that wants to remember, which is a mind that has relinquished its insane desire to control reality. The memory of God can dawn only in a mind that wants to remember the memory of God, a mind that has relinquished the insane desire to control reality. The memory of God can dawn only in a mind that has relinquished the insane desire to control reality. You who cannot even control yourselves should hardly aspire to control the universe. Just look upon what you have made and rejoice it's not so. Children of God, don't be content with nothing. What is not real cannot be seen and has no value. Nor could you receive it, what has no value. God can't offer what has no value, nor could you receive it. You were healed and corrected the instant that you thought you had deserted him. You were redeemed, brought back the instant you thought you had deserted God. Everything you made has never been and is invisible, because the Holy Spirit doesn't see it. Yet what Holy Spirit does see is yours to see. And through Holy Spirit's vision, your perception is healed. You have made the invisible the only truth that this world holds. You have made invisible the only truth this world holds. Valuing nothing, you have sought nothing and you have found nothing. By making nothing real to you, you have seen it. By making nothing real to you, you have seen the nothing, the invisible, but it is not there. And now Christ is invisible to you because of what you've made visible to yourselves. Yet it doesn't matter how much distance you have tried to interpose between your awareness and the truth. It doesn't matter how much distance you have tried to impose between your awareness and what's true. You can be seen because your vision is shared. The Holy Spirit looks upon you and sees nothing else in you. And so what is invisible to you is perfect in Holy Spirit's sight, and what is invisible to you encompasses all of His sight. Holy Spirit has remembered you because your divine indweller didn't forget the Father. You looked upon the unreal and found despair. You looked for the unreal and you found despair. Yet by seeking the unreal, what else could you find besides despair? The unreal world is a thing of despair because the unreal world can never be. It's an illusion. And you who share God's being with Him, you could never be content without reality. What God did not give you has no power over you. And the attraction of love for love remains irresistible. Love's attraction to you and your attraction to love remains irresistible. And what God did not give you has no power over you. And the attraction of love for love remains irresistible. Because it is the function of love to unite all things unto itself. Love's function is to unite all things unto itself and to hold all things together by extending its wholeness. That's love's function. The real world was given you by God in loving exchange for the world you made and which you see. Just take the real world from the hand of Christ and look upon it. The real world's reality will make everything else invisible. For beholding the real world, that's total perception. You'll forget everything else. And as you look upon the real world, you will remember that it always was. It was always so. When you remember the real world, you will remember that it always was so. That it was always so. Nothingness will become invisible. You won't be seeing the unreal. You won't be seeing the ego. For you will at last have seen truly. You'll have seen the real world. Corrected and healed perception is easily translated into knowledge, for only perception is capable of error, and perception has never been. Being corrected, perception gives place to knowledge. Being corrected, perception gives place to knowledge. Knowledge, which is forever the only reality. This course and this curriculum is just the way back to what was never lost. Because your Creator could never cease to love its creation. Your father could not cease to love you. Your creator could not cease to love you. Guiltlessness and invulnerability. Guiltlessness and invulnerability. If you did not feel guilty, you could not attack. For condemnation is the root of attack. Condemnation is the judgment of one mind by another as unworthy of love and deserving of punishment. But herein lies the split. For the mind that judges, the mind that is judging the other mind as unworthy of love and deserving punishment, that mind perceives itself as separate from the mind it's judging. Believing that by punishing and condemning another, it will escape punishment itself, is the mind that judges another mind as unworthy of love and deserving of punishment. All this is just the delusional attempt of the mind to deny itself and escape the penalty of denial. It's not an attempt to relinquish denial, but to hold on to it, for it is guilt that has obscured the Father to you, and it is guilt that has driven you insane. If you did not feel guilty, you could not attack. For condemnation is the root of attack. Condemnation is the judgment of one mind by another mind as unworthy of love and deserving of punishment. But here's the split, because the mind that's making that judgment sees itself as separate from the mind it's judging. That mind, the judging mind, is believing that by judging the other one, punishing the other one, that it will escape punishment. And while I'm judging like that, it is just the delusional attempt of my mind to deny itself and escape the penalty of denial. My judging others as unworthy of love and deserving punishment is not an attempt to get rid of or relinquish my guilt, but to hold on to my guilt. Because it is guilt that has hidden the Creator to us, and it is guilt that has driven us insane. That's all that's going on when my mind judges another mind as unworthy of love and deserving of punishment. The acceptance of guilt into the mind of God's children was the beginning of the separation. The acceptance of guilt into our minds, the mind of God's children, was the beginning of the separation. Just as the acceptance of the healing is the separation's end. The acceptance of guilt into the mind of God's children was the beginning of the separation, just like the acceptance of the truth is separation's end. The world you see is the delusional system of those made mad by guilt. Look carefully at this world, and you will realize that this world is the delusional system of those made mad by guilt. Look carefully at the world, and you will realize this is so, For this world is the symbol of punishment, and all the laws which seem to govern the world are the laws of death and punishment. For instance, children are born into the world through pain and in pain. Children's growth is attended by suffering, and they learn of sorrow and separation and death, and their minds seem to be trapped in their brain, and their powers seem to decline if their bodies are hurt. These children, these people seem to love, yet they desert, and they are deserted, and they appear to lose what they love, perhaps the most insane belief of all, and their bodies then wither and gasp and are laid in the ground and seem to be no more. Not one of these folks have thought that God is cruel. Look carefully at this world, and you will realize that it is the delusional system of those made mad by guilt. A delusional system of those made mad by guilt. Of course, that world is going to be the symbol of punishment, where all the laws that seem to govern are the laws of death. In a delusional system of those made mad by guilt, of course, children will be born into it through pain and in pain and growth attended by suffering. Of course, that's the world that we would see, where there is a delusional system of those made mad by guilt. The acceptance of guilt into our mind was the beginning of the separation, just like the acceptance of the correction of guilt is the separation's ending. If this were the real world, then God would be cruel. But no father could subject his children to this as the price of salvation and be loving. Love doesn't kill to save. If it did, attack would be salvation, and that attack is salvation is the ego's interpretation, but not God's. Only the world of guilt could demand this, that love kill to save. Only the world of guilt could demand that. You have to be killed to be saved. Only the world of guilt could demand this, for only the guilty could conceive of that, needing to be killed to be saved. Adam's so-called sin could have touched none of you had you not believed that it was the Father who drove you out of paradise, him, Adam, out of paradise. Adam's so-called sin could have touched none of you had you not believed that it was the Father who drove Adam out of paradise. For in that belief, that it was the Father that drove Adam out of paradise, that the knowledge of the Father Creator was lost, since only those who do not understand the Father Creator could believe that the Father of Love could drive Adam out of paradise. This world is a picture of the crucifixion of God's children. And until you realize that God's children cannot be crucified, this is the world you will see. Yet you will not realize this until you accept the eternal fact that God's children are not guilty. You will not realize this, that you can't be crucified, and that no child of God can be crucified. You will not realize this until you accept the eternal fact that God's child is not guilty. God's children deserve only love because they have given only love. God's children cannot be condemned because God's children have never condemned. The correction of guilt called The Atonement, is the final lesson that we need learn. For it teaches us that never having sinned, we have no need of salvation. The Course in Miracles is the final lesson we need learn, because A Course in Miracles teaches us that never having sinned, we have no need of salvation. Long ago we said that the Holy Spirit shares the goal of all good teachers, whose ultimate aim is to make themselves unnecessary. Holy Spirit's aim is to make itself unnecessary, because the Holy Spirit shares the goal of all good teachers, whose ultimate aim is to make themselves unnecessary by teaching their pupils all they know. The Holy Spirit wants to teach you all it knows. For sharing the Father's love for you, the Holy Spirit in you wills to remove all guilt from your mind. The Holy Spirit shares its Father's love for you. And so the Holy Spirit wants to remove all guilt from your mind so that you may remember your Father in peace. Because peace and guilt are antithetical, and the Father can be remembered only in peace. Love and guilt cannot coexist. And to accept one is to deny the other. Guilt hides the real you and the real them from your sight. Because guilt is the denial of the blamelessness of God's children. And so guilt hides the Christ in God's children from your sight. In this strange world which you have made, you have sinned. How could you see God's children then? By making God's children invisible in sin, then the world of retribution rose in the black cloud of guilt which you accepted and you hold dear. Because the blamelessness of God's children is the proof that the ego never was and never can be. The blamelessness of the children of God is the proof that the ego never was and can never be. Without guilt, the ego has no life, and you are without guilt. And so as you look upon yourselves and judge what you do honestly, as you have been asked to do, you may be tempted to wonder how you could be guiltless, or how you can be guiltless. Yes, as you look upon yourselves and judge what you do honestly, as you've been asked to do, you may be tempted to wonder how you could be guiltless. Indeed. Yet consider this. You are not guiltless in time, but in eternity. You have, quote, sinned in the past, but there is no past. Always has no direction. Time seems to go in one direction. But when you reach time's end, time will roll up like a long carpet which has spread along the past behind you, and it will disappear. And as long as you believe that you are guilty, you will walk along this carpet, believing that this carpet leads to death. And the journey will seem long, and the journey will seem cruel, and the journey will seem senseless, for so it is. The journey which we have set ourselves is foolish indeed. But the journey on which our Father sets us is a journey of release and joy. The Father is not cruel, and the Father's children cannot hurt themselves. And so the retaliation that we, God's children, fear and which we see will never touch us. For even though we believe in this retaliation that we think is touching us, the loving right mind knows that the retaliation is not true. The Holy Spirit in you stands at the end of time where you must be, because Holy Spirit is with you. Holy Spirit in your mind has always undone everything unworthy of you and your innocence, because that was the Holy Spirit in you's mission. Given Holy Spirit that mission by God, and what God gives has always been. You will see me as you learn that the children of God are guiltless. You will see me as you learn that you, the child of God, are guiltless. The children of God, us, have always sought our guiltlessness. And we have found our guiltlessness. For everyone is seeking to escape from the prison they have made. And the way to find release is not denied us. The way to find release being in us, we have found it. When we find the way to find release from our prison, when we find the escape from the prison we have made, is only a matter of time. When we find that escape from the prison we've made, when we find the way to release, is only a matter of time, and time is but an illusion. Because the children of God, the child of God, is guiltless now. And the brightness of our purity shines untouched forever in God's mind. We will always be as we were created. Deny your world and don't judge the children of God. Deny your world and don't deny the children of God. Don't deny the children of God. Don't judge the children of God. Judge your world, deny your world. Because their eternal guiltlessness is in the mind of their Creator and protects us forever. Our eternal guiltlessness is in the mind of the Creator and protects us forever. When you have accepted the atonement, which is the correction of your guilt, then you will realize that there is no guilt in you. And only as you look upon yourself and others as guiltless can you understand your oneness. For the idea of guilt brings a belief in condemnation of one by another. The idea of guilt brings a belief in condemnation of one by another, projecting separation in place of unity. You can condemn only yourself. And by so condemning yourself, you cannot know that you are God's beloved child. You've denied the condition of your being, which is your perfect blamelessness. Out of love you were created, and in love you abide. Goodness and mercy have always followed you, for you have always extended the love of your Father. As you perceive the holy companions who travel with you, you'll realize that there is no journey, just an awakening. The children of God, who sleepeth not, have kept faith with their Father for you. There is no road to travel on. There is no time to travel through, because God doesn't wait for God's creation in time, because God's forever unwilling to be without God's children. And so it's always been that you've been in God. Let the guiltlessness of God's children shine away the cloud of guilt that darkens your mind. Let the guiltlessness of God's children shine away the cloud of guilt that darkens your mind. And by accepting their guiltlessness as your guiltlessness, learn of them that their guiltlessness is your guiltlessness. You are invulnerable because you are guiltless. You can hold on to the past only through guilt, because guilt establishes that you will be punished for what you have done, and thus depends on one-dimensional time proceeding from past to future. You can hold on to the past only through guilt. And the reason you can hold on to the past only through guilt is because guilt establishes that you will be punished for what you did in the past. And so guilt depends on one-dimensional time proceeding from past to future. No one who believes this, that they'll be punished for what they've done, no one who believes that can understand what always means. And therefore, guilt must deprive you of the appreciation of eternity. Guilt must deprive you of the appreciation of eternity. Because guilt will always be taking you back to the past, from past to future. So, guilt must deprive you of the appreciation of eternity. You are immortal because you are eternal, and you and always must be now. You are immortal because you are eternal, and always must be now. Guilt, then, is a way of holding past and future in your minds to ensure your ego's continuity, is guilt. Guilt, a way of holding past and future in your minds to ensure your ego's continuity, guilt is a way of holding past and future in your minds to ensure your ego's continuity, because if what has been will be punished, then the ego's continuity is guaranteed. Yet the guarantee of your continuity is God's, not your ego's. And immortality is the opposite of time, because time passes away, while immortality is constant. And so, accepting the plan for the correction of your guilt, accepting the curriculum for the correction of your guilt, teaches you what immortality is. So as your guilt is released, you begin to learn what immortality is. And by accepting your guiltlessness, you learn that the past has never been, and so the future is needless. The future in time is always associated with expiation, and only guilt could induce a sense of need for expiation, something to pass by. or to end. Accepting the guiltlessness of God's children as your guiltlessness is therefore God's way of reminding you of His children and what they are in truth. Because God has never condemned His children. And being guiltless, God's children are eternal. God has never condemned His children. And being guiltless, God's children are eternal. So you can dispel guilt by making it. You cannot dispel guilt by making it real and then atoning for it, being punished for it. You cannot dispel guilt by making it real and then punishing yourself for it. That's the ego's plan. That's the ego's plan of dispelling guilt. What's the ego's plan for dispelling guilt? Making it real and then punishing yourself for it. That's your ego's plan for dispelling guilt. And this plan that your ego offers you for dispelling guilt, which is make that guilt real and then punish yourself for it, that plan the ego offers you instead of dispelling it. And this is because the ego believes in correction and healing. The ego believes that dispelling guilt is through attack. And the ego is fully committed to the insane notion that attack is atonement. And you who cherish guilt must also believe that attack is atonement, that attack is correction. You who cherish guilt must also believe in the insane notion that attack is correction, that attack is atonement. For how else but by identifying with the ego could you hold dear what you don't want, which is retribution and attack? Your ego teaches you to attack yourself because you are guilty. Your ego teaches you to attack yourself because you're guilty. Your ego teaches you to attack yourself because you're guilty. And this must increase the guilt, for guilt is the result of attack. The ego teaches you to attack yourself, you're guilty, which increases the guilt, because this guilt is the result of attack. In the ego's teaching, then, there is no escape from guilt. In the ego's teaching, then, there is no escape from guilt. Because attack makes guilt real, and if guilt is real, there is no way to overcome it. Your loving right mind dispels guilt simply through the calm recognition that your guilt has never been. And as the Holy Spirit looks upon your guiltlessness, Holy Spirit knows that that's true about you. And being true for you, your guiltlessness, you cannot attack yourself. For without guilt, attack is impossible. You then are saved because you are guiltless, and being wholly pure, you are invulnerable.